Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining. My name is Scott, and today I'm going to be talking about my journey from living and working abroad to my current role as Amazon product manager here in Seattle. And I'm going to be doing that through the lens of 12 books that have been really helpful for me. So the agenda of today's talk is basically, we'll do just a bit about me, so you kind of understand my background and where I'm coming from. 5 minutes on two stints I did abroad. One was in Mexico for about 3 years, and then one was a trip around the world I did in 2014. And then for the remainder of the presentation, I'm just going to be talking about some books that I'd like to highlight. It's just one slide per book, so obviously we won't go into too much depth, but hopefully this will give you a flavor for what the book's about, why I found it helpful, in case you'd like to pick the book up and read it yourself. So first, we'll start with a little bit about me. First, on the personal side, on the left here, you see my family. So this is Victoria. She's 18 months old, and she's super cute. This is my wife, Maria, and our Weimaraner dog, Nova. And then just kind of on the personal side, I like to do outdoor stuff. This was actually last weekend, in Bellingham, Washington. This, is my daughter, Victoria, laying it down on the synthesizer. And, this is me back in 2005, rocking the Afro before a basketball game. So yeah. And then, just about me professionally, I studied at the University of Tennessee in Knoxville, and then shortly after graduating, moved to Mexico City as part of a bi-national business Fulbright program, which I'll talk about a little more. Then spent almost 3 years in Mexico, and then went to business school at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville. And did an internship at Amazon in the summer of 2015, and then came back full-time first into the finance program, and then later as a product manager. And currently I work on the delivery experience team. The delivery experience team is kind of the customer-facing team for the delivery, kind of the shopping journey that you might be familiar with Amazon from, all the way from searching for a product to selecting when, how you want that product delivered. And then the, from when you order until when you get it, make sure that that process is seamless. If it's running late, we'll let you know with notifications and make sure that that's your product's arrived seamlessly. So yeah, it's a little bit about me and my background. So next we'll hop into the international nomad bit of this. So as I mentioned, I did some time in Mexico through this binational business program, super cool program. Basically, I had the opportunity to live a year in Mexico with these other Fulbright scholars, and we worked at Mexican companies or nonprofits during the day, and then went to school at night, and just learned a ton, got to practice Spanish and learn about Mexican business culture, and it was just a whole lot of fun. I worked at a nonprofit named Ashoka. Ashoka focuses on social entrepreneurship and specifically like early stage. So I'm a social entrepreneur. I'm, working on my idea. Maybe I'm doing it part-time with my day job. Ashoka gives grants for that stage entrepreneur to make their idea a reality and then scale up, with the idea being that after, 3 years of kind of a stipend, then the entrepreneur can work on their idea full-time. After that, And so I got the chance to meet a number of really just amazing entrepreneurs in Mexico. Highlighted three here. Enrique, who does water captation. There's some like severe water shortage problems in Mexico City, especially in the like informal housing parts of the city. So Enrique is working on solving that problem with his Isla Urbana kind of hybrid nonprofit and for-profit organizations. Jose Carlos Gonzalez created and runs Green Wallet, which focuses on transforming the Mexican recycling industry, which historically has been like run by mafias and people are like rummaging through dumpsters, into like a more modern and market-based recycling system. And then finally, Javier Lozano has a really awesome model for diabetes clinics in Mexico. Mexico has one of the highest rates of obesity and diabetes. And so Javier's really a pioneer in that. And so really formative experience for me in terms of meeting all these folks, really inspiring the work they're doing. So feel free to reach out to me if you'd like to learn more about that. Following my time in Mexico, I actually, here he is, Jeremy taught me a few things about how to travel around the world using credit card points. And so here's a link if you'd like to learn more on that. But I did about 5 months, you know, bouncing all over the world in this flight named the One World ticket. So it's like 16 flights, and you can buy it using miles and then go all over. I started here in Nashville. There's my sister, Julie, sending me on my way with my travel companion, Charlie Chico. Spent some time in Japan, Korea, China, both in Hong Kong and Guilin, Philippines, did a homestay with these crazy kids, and that was a lot of fun. Spent time in Thailand. These were some protests that I got to witness. Malaysia, did about a month in India, where I got to be an extra in the Bollywood movie Happy New Year with Shah Rukh Khan, who's like the Brad Pitt of India. So that was also super cool. Did some time in Amman, Jordan. You can see me in my Indiana Jones outfit here. Also went to Israel and Palestine. This is a picture of an Israeli soldier kind of patting everybody down in the bus as we go into Palestine. Did some a quick bit in Lagos. This is the MoneyGram team who same guy Jeremy connected me through to the MoneyGram team. They were super helpful in setting me up for like a good time and just learning a lot in Lagos, a little bit in Kenya. So this was Nairobi, and then Lake Naivashana, and we did a safari there, super cool. Popped up to the UK and did a quick layover with my friend Victor, and then the final stint of the trip was in Rio. So here's the motorcycle ride up to the top of the mountain, and here's the view from the top. Really amazing trip. And here I am back in Nashville, meeting up with my now wife, Maria. So pretty awesome trip. Do check out these links if you're interested in doing a similar trip at some point. So after that trip, I was pretty tired out and was gearing up for business school. And so these books that I read will speak a little bit to my journey as a product manager and also just in general navigating professional stuff, not having either a product or finance, you know, background at all. So and so these are kind of in order of how I would approach, like, if you're interested in getting into product management or understanding what it is, that's kind of the high level order. But this book describes really well what is a product owner's job. And I use the word owner because I think it is important to think about your job as an owner, because at the end of the day, you're on the hook for delivering things that customers and users like and enjoy and engage with. But that involves working with senior management, all these, you know, here would be like the software engineers, your scrum master, and then work close with your users. So really cool role. And this book goes a little bit deeper into what does this mean? It's full of stories. You won't be able to read this, but this basically summarizes at the end the 11-step process that you would do if you want to implement Scrum in your workplace. And I found that super helpful, both to have the background stories and then have this like kind of quick start guide. And you can see, like, pick a product owner, pick a team, pick a Scrum master. And that definition of terminology has been really helpful for me. Next up, so imagine you've, you know what a product manager is, and you're about to transition into a product management job. I've found this book helpful in thinking about how to ramp up into your job for like long-term success. So for example, and this is also applicable to starting at Amazon or starting at any new company. And this is advice I give to people where you kind of want to invest in yourself and invest in understanding the situation that you find yourself in. Here, you're going to be consuming value naturally in the first couple days and weeks of your role, but this book will help you accelerate the timeline by which you're able to move from consuming value to producing value. So I found that mental model helpful. Okay, so now you're on the job. Probably the most important relationship that you want to manage is that of your manager. And this book I found helpful, especially when you and your manager aren't like naturally the same style. So I found this book helpful in unpacking like, well, what are the things that I need to do to improve to make sure that I'm performing at a high level? And then thinks about your relationship with your boss as like, you're the protagonist. Like, you know, it's your responsibility to make sure that you're managed well. And I found that concept quite helpful as well. This one's a classic. So, you know, you're on your job, you've met with your boss, set up expectations. The next thing that you should do is get out there and talk to customers. And there's a term in this book and it's called get out of the building. And what it means is like, go out to the street, go do customer interviews, go like, walk through the customer's journey and go talk to them and observe them through that like that purchasing process or engagement process. And that'll really help you move more quickly in designing a product that's meaningful to those customers. And as you can see, that process will then give you ideas. You'll build the scrappiest thing that you can get out the door quickly. Which is your product, then you'll measure, hey, do customers like it or not? Which parts do they like? That will then generate data, which will help you learn. And the faster you can spin around that loop, the better. And this book is helpful for thinking about creative ways to spin up things that can get a reaction from a customer without going through a lot of expensive dev weeks. Really, really important concept and a great book. Thinking about, we talked about how product owner sits in the middle here. I found that often development teams, and in my world, software engineers and data scientists are often introverts, and that makes sense because software engineers and data scientists need to dive deep and really just zone in and have that focus that many extroverts don't have. And so that ability to focus in is what makes great software engineers great. However, myself as an extrovert, it's not necessarily intuitive as to like, well, why isn't the team speaking up in meetings? Or you may feel like, hey, I'm just getting crickets out there. Why don't people speak up? This book was really helpful for me to think through the lens of an introvert in terms of like, how can I, as a product manager, create an environment in which I can more quickly and efficiently connect and build relationships with my development team. So would highly recommend this book. All right, cool. Well, that's the end of the product management books that I recommend. And next we'll get into the motivation and productivity bit. So this book really sits at the core of like why we're motivated to do what we do. You can read the Twitter summary there, but my big takeaway from this book was both like what motivates me and what motivates my team, and unpacking for each person what motivates each person. And so you can see here, talks about autonomy, mastery, getting better and better at something over time, and then purpose. And depending on the person and their point in their career, they might put more weight on one of these things versus the other two. But these three things, I think, really hit at the core of what motivates both me and the people I work with. And starting from there, and that understanding is, I think, really important to kind of get to the core, the root of how to get people just super excited about what they're working on. So next is, this one is called the five choices. And it's similar to, habits of highly effective people, and that we talk about like importance and urgence. It's similar in that way, but it builds upon that concept once you've identified what are the kind of not urgent but highly important tasks that you need to focus on to deliver great products to your customers. How do you, in a world in which we're bombarded with notifications and a bunch of emails and news, how do you figure out what are the big rocks? So this is the step number three that you need to do that require that concentration. Similar to what I mentioned about like what makes software engineers or data scientists really good is that ability to focus. Well, it's actually the same for product managers, thinking about what are the requirements at their core, what are the simplest way to articulate requirements in writing, or writing a document that's really inspiring, those big rocks can't fit in between meetings. You need to block out time. And so this book provides a framework through which you can kind of manage your schedule and your incoming requests before they even hit your desks with fancy tricks like, you know, rules in your Outlook so that you get a message, bling, 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 when your boss emails you, but for, you know, some email listserv that you're a part of, that's not distracting to you as you're in your, you know, big rocks concentration time. And this is a very, very important concept, because if you don't do this stuff, you'll burn out, because we've faced so many decisions, like decision fatigue is real. You're making decisions all the time. And so making sure that those decisions are ones that are decisions that allow you to be extraordinarily productive and not things that are just arbitrary is a super important way to protect against burnout. And kind of zooming all the way out again, I found this book, it's the Tao Te Ching. It's basically just a book of Chinese poems, but it's really helpful to come back to and think about concepts like influence without authority or success and failure. This number 13 is one of there. It's a collection of poems. So there's, this is the number 13 poem, but there's a whole bunch of them. And so I like to come back to this book in kind of like a meditative or like staying grounded type of way. All right, and then finally, some books that I've enjoyed related to business and culture. I group these business and culture together because often the most successful companies are those which have a strong and distinctive culture. And so I'll talk about a couple of those. The first one is, this book by Ben Horowitz, legendary venture capitalist. He tells story after story of just some epic situations that he found himself in, and how did he rationalize having to fire people when his company was going under, or, you know, in the early days of the cloud, and just really awesome set of stories, and it says also a lot about the culture that you want to build in your team and your company, and the culture that you definitely don't want to build. Like, what is corrosive politics and how do you avoid it? Really awesome book. The Good Product Manager, Bad Product Manager, that you might have seen around is this. From this book originally. This book is about Google, how Google works, and it's fascinating, kind of the stories, but also the embedded philosophy about like what has made Google become so successful in delivering all the products that we use, Gmail, YouTube, the whole thing. So put here some hiring do's and don'ts, some kind of like career type advice that I think is relevant for product managers. So yeah, definitely check this book out. And then of course, you know, I work at Amazon. I'm a big fan of the company and the culture, and this book gives a window into kind of the origins of the company, which at the end of the day are kind of these type of stories are the things that shape culture and leadership principles. And so understanding the story behind kind of the founding and evolution of Amazon, I found fascinating. And so that's a good one to check out. And then finally, this one is a book that the Darden School of Business at University of Virginia has you read. It's one of your first books in business school. And it is an older book, but it remains super relevant today. And it talks about like any organization, even, you know, like Amazon trying to, you know, test new stuff in the delivery experience world. It's super important to have this operations mindset and understand as a product and engineering organization where are your bottlenecks. And then also like as a company, like the delivery experience team, we depend on the supply chain optimization team, the transportation team, the warehouse team, all to deliver awesome delivery experiences to customers. And so the concepts in this book are super relevant. And it's also really fun. It's written as a novel as the protagonist goes through and kind of stumbles across these concepts and just great read. So would recommend this one as well. All right. So that concludes this presentation. Hope that you know, you took something away, and if you have any questions, please let me know. And also my email, you can reach out to me via email as well. Thanks.